Good morning. Welcome to Resurrection Sunday at Bindawi United Methodist Church. I'm so glad that you decided to join us this morning at our 9:30 service. May the peace and blessings of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ be with you all. In this time of social distancing, we're not allowed to gather here in our church. So what I propose to do is make an Easter service as normal as possible, to the best of my abilities, with just myself and my wife Rhonda helping with the music this morning. So please bear with us as we attempt to give you as normal a Resurrection Sunday as we can possibly do. Let us start with our centering words. Even in the midst of our Good Friday grief, a sparrow sings in the garden, heralding the morning as sunlight kisses the dewy grass. Our first hymn this morning is going to be Morning Has Broken. Please sing along at home if you know the words. Our call to worship this morning, if you did receive a bulletin electronically, please join along. If not, I will guide you along. Shout for joy, the tomb is empty. Clap your hands, death is cheated. Dance and sing, Christ is risen. Christ is risen. indeed. Our second hymn this morning is Because He Lives. Please join in from home and sing along with us. Because He lives, we can face tomorrow. We can face tomorrow because He is risen. The stone has been rolled away and He is risen. Our prayer concerns this morning are for our world, that we would all remain safe and healthy in this time of Corona or COVID-19 pandemic, that we would pray for the afflicted and their families, and we would remember to be generous and kind and loving to our neighbors. And our joy this morning is that we would celebrate together, virtually, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, from the tomb. The resurrection in which he defeated not only sin, but death itself, and securing for each one of us everlasting life. So let us pray together the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Amen. We'll begin in our scriptures this morning from the book of Acts, chapter 10, 34 to 43. Our readings this morning will be coming from the New International Version. Then Peter began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who was Lord of all. You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a cross. But God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one with whom God appointed as judge of the living and of the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Our second reading is from Psalm 118, and it's verses 1 and 2 and 14 to 24. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. I will not die but live, and will proclaim what the Lord has done. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. And our New Testament reading comes from Colossians 3. And it's only 1 through 4. And it's titled, Living as Those Made Alive in Christ. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. And then we turn to our gospel reading. Our gospel comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, and it will be verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken our Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and he believed. You see, they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels, both dressed in white, seated where Jesus' body had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. Then they asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They've taken my Lord," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and she saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and to your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. The words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Good morning. Welcome to our Resurrection Sunday service. It is my prayer for all of you that you are well, keeping safe, and that you have all that you need. If you have a need, please let me know. Let us begin. We begin in Acts chapter 10, and how fitting it is that we rejoice this morning with believers from around the world, from every nation on the globe, our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Our scripture told to us by Peter, one of the 12, states that he sees clearly that God shows no favoritism. He accepts those from every nation, those who fear him and do what is right. in this time of world pandemic, not only is it a sense of security, knowing that we are beloved children of God, but that no matter where on God's earth someone may be standing at this very moment, if they believe in Jesus, they are saved. No buts, no questions, no fear. That's the message of the good news. Jesus died for our sins. He was nailed to a cross for our transgressions. He shed his precious blood for our defects. And as long as we believe that and put our faith in the fact that 3 days later, Christ walked out of the tomb after being raised from the dead by the will of God the Father who sent him, we have nothing to fear. Because not even death can stop us. For through faith, we were raised with Christ from the grave and granted eternal salvation. Today, we remember not only what Christ did for us on Thursday and on Friday, but we celebrate the miraculous wonder that when Mary went to the tomb, the stone was rolled away. The tomb that had guards placed to watch it. The tomb where Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus placed the dead, lifeless body after taking it down from the cross and wrapping it in strips of linen and somewhere around 75 pounds of burial spices just a few days before. The stone was rolled away. But even better is that Jesus was not there. This is a time to rejoice. As believers, we know from Psalm 118 that Christ is our strength and our defense and our salvation. But let's look at the next few lines as they're spoken to us today in 2020. Here in the tents of righteousness, our video churches, our physical churches, our Zoom services, or whatever form of worship you are experiencing, there are shouts of joy and victory. We celebrate all the wonderful things God has done this morning. First and foremost, in rising from the grave, Christ displayed his power over death, both earthly and eternal death. He defeated death for all time, for like his Father who sent him, Jesus Christ is eternal. Next, the Lord gave to us the gate by which we were to enter to give thanks to his holy name. The gate is Christ. The gate is Jesus. This means we can come to the Father by believing in the Son. No longer would a Pharisee or a chief priest be needed to take our offerings to God. We can do it ourselves through faith because we've entered through the gate. Jesus told us in John 14:16 that he was the way, the truth, and the light. And no one would come to the Father except through Christ himself. But some things had to happen before we could find the gate. As there were scriptures and prophecies to be fulfilled, God's purpose had to be completed. So Jesus came, born to a virgin named Mary by Immaculate Conception, and lived a simple, humble life, working as a carpenter. He was educated in Jewish tradition, often asking questions of and sharing his special insight with the teachers in the temple. It wasn't until Jesus was 30 years old that he began his public ministry. Christ began by being baptized by his cousin, John the Baptist, in the Jordan. This too was a fulfillment of prophecy, that John would go before Jesus and prepare the way for him and his ministry. Then he chose his 12. He chose those that he would travel, eat, sleep, laugh, and teach over the next 3 years. They would be together right up until his death on the cross. The death also foretold in the scriptures. Now the chosen that he had selected spent 3 years listening to Jesus, learning from his teachings. Yet they were naive still when it came to Jesus explaining what was going to happen once he was arrested and left them. We can't blame them, I suppose. No one had ever foretold their own death and resurrection, so they had nothing to go on. But they, the 12 or the 11, would come to put the pieces of the teachings together.